If you want to check a normal number if it's prime, a small one, you just see if any numbers divide into it. You can get slightly smarter. You've only got to check if primes divide into it, and you've only got to check if primes up to the size of the square root of the number you're checking or not. And so there's a few shortcuts you can make. This number, however, when you're finding some, look at the size of this thing, right? There's no way you could just go through and check every conceivable prime factor of this number to see if it itself is prime. In fact, there's a much more clever way of doing it. Well, I have successfully divided it by 3, so I don't know if that, it technically doesn't count as a, I mean, I've taken a prime and I've split it into 3 parts, albeit not 3 equal parts. If anyone's curious, it's 1,490 pages, but I double-sided them, so it's about 250 pages of volume. Okay, you want to find primes. Previously, I showed you the Lucas numbers, which I prefer to Fibonacci numbers. These are the vastly superior Lucas numbers. They start with 1 and 3 instead of 1, 1 Fibonacci, and then they carry on exactly the same. You get 4, you get 7, you get 11. I need to make sure I get this correct, otherwise it will be very, very embarrassing. And what's that going to be? 47. So there's the first one, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So Brady, can you give me any number, 1 to 10 inclusive? What would you like? Anything, 1 to 9, 1 to 10. What do you want?
5.
Okay, so we're going to see if 5 is prime. Now, a lot of people at home, because the people who watch Numberphile tend to be into mathematics, know 5 is prime. Spoiler. Let's say we don't know. Say, I don't know if 5's prime or not. Let's double check. I'm going to count along to the 5th Lucas number. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm going to subtract 1 off that number. And if I subtract 1, I get 10. And then I check, is 10 a multiple of 5? And it is. And because 10 is 2 times 5, 10 is a multiple of 5, I know 5 is a prime number.
What?
Probably. Okay. Give me another number that's not prime. Just, you know.
6.
I wonder if 6 is prime. Let's check 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Take 1 off. 17. 17 is not a multiple of 6. 6 is not prime. And 6 is definitely not prime. And so this Lucas test, it will rule out a number that's not prime. So you can comprehensively prove a number is not prime by using this test, even though you don't know what any of the factors are. If it does pass, then we call it a Lucas pseudo-prime. It's very likely it's going to be prime, but it's not guaranteed at this point. So this is a very easy test. It's a good first filter to check if a number is prime or not, and you don't even have to look at its factors. So for a number this big, first of all, we need something a little bit more clever, and secondly, we want to be sure, right? So we want a similar test which guarantees it definitely is prime if we find it, and that's what we're going to do now. Right, for the big fellas, we need a different sequence, and again, it's our friend Lucas, what a guy, what a mathematician, and a guy called Lima, who we never met because he lived much later after him, and he was French and American, but together they came up with this method which uses the following sequence. You start with 4 this time, and then after that you square the previous number and subtract 2. So 4 squared is 16, 16 subtract 2 is 14. And then we do the same thing. We square 14, we subtract 2, and you get 194. You then square 194, subtract 2, you get 37,634. They get big very quickly. So the next one's a bit of a monster. So you go from 37,000 something, 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 up here to 1,416,317,954. And then now you can see what's going to happen. We're about to square this guy. They're getting roughly twice as long each time. The next number, hold on, is 2 billion. This escalates very quickly, and you end up with some massive numbers in there. And so actually it becomes incredibly very unwieldy very quickly to do anything with it. We'll fix that problem in a moment. Let's start by proving a number is prime. We're going to use a small Mersenne prime on this sequence to start with. I'm going to use 7 because it is 1 less than 2 cubed. So the way you check a Mersenne prime against this list is you take the power, which for 7 is 3, you subtract 1 off that, which is 2, and you find what's in the second position in the list. So the second number is 14, and you see if that is a multiple of the number you're checking, 7. And it is, look at that. So 14 is a multiple of 7, so 7 is definitely prime.
All right.
let's recap on that very quickly. If you've got 2 to some p prime power there, minus 1, and that equals some mystery number, if the p minus 1th position in this sequence is a multiple of that number is definitely prime. And there's no ifs or buts or maybes. We know it is absolutely prime. And if it's not a multiple of that number, it's definitely not prime. And so this is a primality test. You can check if a number is prime or not, and you never have to look at its factors. This is what Lucas used. He managed to prove that 2 to the 127 minus 1 is definitely prime by finding the 126th term in this sequence and proving it was a multiple of that massive number that came out the other side. He also amazingly managed to prove that 2 to the 67 minus 1 is not prime, but he never found a single factor for that number. He was able to prove this is not prime without finding a number that divides into it. I think that's amazing. It was much later on, decades later, someone actually found what the factors were. We knew they were there, we used to know what they were, but we knew it wasn't prime. That prime is actually the biggest prime that was found by hand. All primes after that have been done by computer. So to check this number here, what we would have to do is continue this sequence, find the 74,207,280th position and check if it was a multiple of this monstrosity. Now that actually is going to take a ridiculous amount of computing power. You can see how big these numbers get. They're going to get ludicrously large, and so actually that is not a good way to go about it. Let's make our life easy. Because when you're searching through for this guy here, all you care is whether or not the 74,207,280th position is a multiple of it or not. All you really want to know are the remainders once you've divided by this number. And so as you go along, you don't have to keep track of the entire Lucas-Lima sequence. You just need to keep track of the remainder mod this number as you go along. So you can keep simplifying it down each step of the way. And we can do a quick example if you want to show how that works. One of my absolute favorite Mersenne primes is 8,191, which is 2 to the 13 subtract 1. And so to check this number, we would have to find the 12th term in the Lucas-Lima sequence, but we only have to find it mod 8191. So to start with, it's the same. You'd have 4, you'd square that, you'd get 14, you'd square that, you'd get 194. Let's get these right. Then the next number should be 37,634, but that's bigger than the number we care about. And so actually, we need the remainder of that number once we've divided through this number. In that case, it's only 4,870. That's easier. And then we square that, subtract 2, get the remainder once we remove multiples of the number we care about, and you end up with 3,953 followed by 5,970. And you can see this time these are staying much more manageable inside. Okay, then 128, and then the 12th term is 0. If you square that, subtract 2, you get a multiple of 8,191, and because that 0, there's no remainder, we know whatever that massive, ridiculous number should have been in the sequence, it's definitely a multiple of 8,191, therefore, that is definitely prime, and we didn't have to check a single factor of that number. Okay, so this is what the computer at the University of Missouri did, although obviously it does a slightly more efficient version of this, and there's some nice things you can do with the way it handles the binary versions of these numbers. Anyway, it's a fancy version of going along this sequence, finding the result modulo this ridiculous number, but you can do that just by subtracting it off until you get a number smaller than it, so that's not so bad. Once it got to that position, it looked at the answer, there was no remainder, and normally there's a remainder. The vast majority of the times you'll check a number of this size, spend a month on it, the computer will get to the end and go, ah, there's a remainder. Well, it's a computer, it's got no emotions. It would just send back the remainder to the central server. On this occasion, it was 0. The computer had no idea what it had done. It sent that off back to the central server, and that was it. We had found the biggest prime number known to humankind. So the problem is, this method only works for Mersenne primes. But actually, the problem is, every single time you do it, it's a month of processing work, right? And so you think, how many, I mean, this is millions and millions of months. But obviously, we only have to check the way Mersenne primes work, and there are some fantastic Numberphile videos on Mersenne primes, you only got to worry about prime values up here. And so once, if this hadn't been prime, if that had not worked, the next one checked would have been the next prime up after this. And so we're gradually ticking up through those primes. You're right. In the bigger scheme of things, there aren't that many, but it's still, it's a month every time you want to check one. So, I mean, definitely everyone download GIMPs, the computer program, and run it, and maybe you'll be the person who finds the next one of these.
Matt, if they put some of the world's more high-powered computers onto the case here for like a few months, would they burn through this? Like, is it silly that we're just using little small computers in universities?
Yeah, no, it's a very good point. If we did have a big high-powered computer, like if Google went, you know what, guys, borrow the server. You know what, I reckon if Google really wanted to, they could just go and find the next one. If they just, for everyone stop searching for a day, we've got something to do with our computers. But then again, I mean, what are they going to achieve? They're going to find a bigger one, and then everyone's like, oh, okay, and start searching for the next one. I mean, the point of this is kind of the hunt. And the fact that thousands of people run the program, and any one of those people could find the next one. That, for me, is the beauty of the project. It could be anyone sitting at home running their computer could make a substantial find like this that could contribute something to mathematics, and for all of eternity, you would be the human that found that prime number.
What would it mean to you if your computer found the next big one?
Oh my goodness, I would be so excited if I found the next. I would absolutely love to find it. I mean, very small confession, I don't run GIMPs on my computer. I run a competing prime number searching outfit called Prime Grid. And so Prime Grid searches for other types of primes. So look for like germain primes and other ones. And so currently GIMPs have the top 15 biggest primes. They found them all. Prime Grid, it's a lot less likely you'll find a prime, which is a bit sad for me. But if they do find one in a few categories, they're going to come in at something crazy big. And so I play for the underdog. So I support Prime Grid because I like the fact they're doing different types. I mean, these GIMPs guys are just in it for the glory. They're just going for the low-hanging, easy, big ones. They're just picking them off one after the other and getting all the recognition. But, you know, I like the fact that as we speak, at home, my computer is doing maths, so I don't have to. The question everyone has is always, what does it begin and end with? Ending, I don't find, everyone loves the last number. But the trouble with the last number is you know it's not going to be an even number. You know it's not going to be a 5. You know it's not going to be a 0. Turns out it's a 1. There it is.